Thank you. Yeah, hello everybody. My talk today is about resilience through architecture and energy efficiency. It's a little bit a shame that the quality of this data projection is so poor. I wanted to show you, I'd like to show you the pyramids here behind the city. But it doesn't matter to the topic. In terms of resilience, I wanted to concentrate on energy efficiency. We could talk also on resilience about, let's say, aesthetics. If you look around here for the building situation, I find this also a very important talk, but maybe these aesthetic problems I cannot solve with techniques and building construction so much, so I prefer to stay with energy efficiency. Energy efficiency, of course, is a very important topic. As we all know, about 50% of all energy consumption is done or used in building issues, mainly for heating, for cooling here as well, for lighting, and also for the green energies which are in the building construction and in the material itself. So energy efficiency is a problem which has to be solved worldwide, and there are initiatives worldwide, of course, but I want to point out some differences, different preconditions under which energy efficiency is seen, for example, in the MENA region and, let's say, in Europe. If I come to Europe first, energy efficiency or energy conservation is mainly seen under the umbrella of global warming to reduce the carbon dioxide emissions, and it's about our knowledge that we know that the fossil energy resources are decreasing. In Germany, we also have the special issue that we decided to get rid of our nuclear power plants. So this puts an additional pressure on energy efficiency to us. And energy change in Europe, and especially in Germany, for this special issue is wished for. Of course, we have to pay for an energy change, which means we want to use mainly renewable energies for energy production and to save energies through energy efficiency. Otherwise, or at the same time, and we have to pay a price for this change, of course. People in Germany, for example, realize that electricity prices are rising and start to complain about it. So energy efficiency in this context becomes also an answer to save energies to deal with the higher prices. It's an economic kind of issue. When I go to the MENA region here, it's different. We know, of course, all of the problems here, which comes from the population rise and the population structure itself in the MENA region. A lot of poor people are living there, and there is a need, of course, in the MENA region to subsidize energy for this due to this population structure, and also structure to subsidize the energy in most countries of the MENA region, and on the other hand, I wanted to say we have the situation that the state budgets can hardly afford subsidize these energies, especially in countries like Egypt, where the subsidization is to a very vast amount, and it is not easy to change there, because any rising in the energy prices can provoke unrest in the population, and you have to be careful with these issues as well. I wanted to come back just to shortly to explain how we achieve energy efficiency in Germany. Basically, we do this with construction-wise and technology-wise. Not so much the majority, I would say. We don't do it planning-wise. For example, here we come with our building codes closer and closer. The demands our building codes give us, we come closer and closer to the so-called passive house. And passive house technique is basically to use an excellent insulation to reduce the energy transmission through all the envelope, to have perfect windows, triple glazed windows, thermally separated window frames, to assemble the building parts in a way that the building construction becomes airtight. And because of this airtightness, we still have to breathe in our houses in Germany. We need an artificial ventilation system, and this usually comes with a heat recovery system. This means the incoming air, fresh air, will be warmed up by the outgoing waste air. Then we have additional techniques, but these additional techniques can be used. They are not. It is not necessary that we use, for example, solar cells for electricity production or for solar power for water heating or geothermal energies, heat pumps, and so on. I would say that these techniques, this kind of energy efficiency, makes sense in countries like Germany. For Egypt, I would think to come to the passive house might be a little bit over exaggerated. Maybe we could achieve energy efficiency in an easier way. I will come to this a little bit later. Now I want to see different conditions we have in different countries here in the MENA region, and make the jump to Abu Dhabi and Saudi Arabia. It is the case that Saudi Arabia uses almost a third of its own energy production just for their own energy needs, and Abu Dhabi uses about 50% of its energy just for water desalination. This is by far too much, but both are rich countries, they can afford a lot, and I see something like Master City, like a big experimentation field for the future of these countries, for the time when the oil will be run off. And Andreas also showed us his settlement in Dubai. So there are tries in these countries for a different and more sustainable, and I say it in the same word now, resilient energy solution. If I make another step towards Jordan, Jordan is a country where there are almost no fossil energy resources. Everything has to be imported, and also it's one of the most water scarce countries in the world. And parts of the country are rich, but the country in general, it's not very rich. So Jordan is a country which stopped the subsidizing of oil, for example, and reaches market prices now,
it's still subsidizing gas. Gas is used in cylinders mainly for lower and middle classes to, for heating and cooking purposes. And there are problems with this. There are protests and so on about the rising energy prices in the country. And on the same time, the kingdom tries to develop or has developed building codes to come to more energy efficiency. They also try to work on the construction side, not so much on the planning side. If you come to West Amman, you have a picture which is here on the board. These white stone cladded buildings, pretty much all looking the same. And the city extends kind of uncontrolled into the few fertile land which Jordan has. And just in this western direction, it's fertile in the direction of Madaba. Nobody seems to control here any planning issue. When it comes to building construction, there are codes for using insulation material now. Amman is, or can be, quite cold. It's usually quite cold in the winter time. Once or twice it can be snowing there due to the altitude of 1,100 meters on the highest points. And in summer it becomes very hot. So insulation makes sense, but of course the use of this insulation material cannot be controlled. There is no enforcement for this for these building codes, which are there are sets so that people anyway do what they want. And what I find out that it is used in a not appropriate way. So if you see the wall construction here, which usually consists of hollow block stones. Here we have the insulation material, polystyrene. And this big mass, building mass here, the terminal mark is concrete, and it is used to fix the stone cladding. Usually it's a limestone, which is fixed with these concrete towards the wall. So this insulation material, as we can see, stops on the usual concrete building structure. So we have the terminal bridges here over the building structure, also over the slabs, and the thermal mass, which would be very needed to the inside for balancing the quite high temperature differences, is unfortunately to the outside. There are lots of such things which I could watch when I was in Jordan. For example, here what they like to use is these shutter boxes over the window. People think this is for energy efficiency reason, but they don't use insulation inside, so it's basically a hole in the wall. And windows themselves are sliding windows consisting of aluminium hollow profiles in the framing and single glazing. So high heat transmittance and also air leaking everywhere in these buildings. The same disaster we still find in the office and commercial buildings. Most of these buildings have an envelope from glass, tinted glass, and as we all know, this high glass content overheats the building on the inside, so we are totally dependent on air conditioning here. And also cannot make use of any thermal masses for the building. I just make a jump here, come to Cairo, because I find a nice solution for this in the American University, where we also have a glass facade here on the inside, but a kind of shelter, framing around the pathway, which protects and shades this glass facade. So it's quite a nice shading solution here. Yeah, jumping to Egypt, while has told us a lot of the conditions we find here in Egypt, not so much of the existing conditions, but of what is happening here and about possible changes in building construction and maybe technologies in Egypt. But the situation still is alarming, as energy consumption is rising each year about 77%, and 43 billion Egyptian pounds were spent by the Egyptian government in the year 2007-2008, probably it's maybe 50,000 now, just for subsidizing the energy prices here in the country. And who has been here last summer in Egypt has experienced a lot of energy cuts, and most of these cuts, of course, were in the poorer areas, not so much in the areas where the rich people live. And the government talks about erecting new power plants. Most of this power is produced by fossil energies, and I think in gas in a high number, about 98-97%. In a country which has a complete abundance of, for example, sun energy and an alternative and renewable energy which is almost not used. And this, of course, is in direct connection with the low energy subsidized energy prices on the other hand. I believe this cannot continue. The problems will rise, and also the prices, the government somehow will have to slowly start to rise the prices for the energy, and maybe this creates also more options for using renewable energies again, because the payback time will become shorter. I want to point out three points which I see as kind of layering for an energy efficient planning, I start with the planning, I come to the construction, and then I come to the technology layer. So when I talk, I should also mention here, I mentioned a little bit the abundance of sun energy which is available here in these countries, and every sustainable or resilient planning, architectural planning, of course, should start with the climate conditions prevailing in the country or on the site we are planning for. This is first, of course, the sun energies, the sun intensities we have, temperatures, humidity, wind direction and strength we have on the place, on the site. And out of this conditions we find with the climate on the place, on the site, I define the climate as repeated weather conditions on a site, on a place. Out of these conditions, we should then come to planning. We want to have an energy efficient planning, and this means, for example, first to think in an urban scale, which type of houses are appropriate to save energy. I have an example here in the upper row on the outskirts of Cairo. All these new areas in Cairo, buildings look about the same like this. And the lower picture, lower example is designed by Alvaro Ziza in Portugal, in the small city of Évora. And of course, this is a little bit denser, and in terms of energy consumption, you could say, the certain volume ratio might be a little bit better than in this house is due to the higher density, but on the other hand, you need a lot of input energy just for the construction and for the running utilities and techniques into the house. So you have unclear and unequal situations, lighting situations, because the windows usually don't care for some directions. There is no good ventilation possibility, and also we don't have these outdoor spaces here, these small little courtyard houses are giving to the people, which also attributes, of course, for resilience, even for the climate, as you can use it for the ventilation or for the cool air which settles down in the night in small courtyards. So I was mentioning planning as the initial start for energy efficient housing, and orientation, of course, is maybe the most important, and where do I set the windows to reduce the input of the sun for the heat gains. If I can reduce this, maybe through shading or maybe through windows orientating to other sides, or also the sizes, of course, of the windows are important, then I can just save a lot of energies, and it's better to save energies first before I start to produce energies. Coming to the building construction, we find the same as in many countries around here. Basically, we have a concrete skeleton construction filled with bricks, sometimes with limestones. In Egypt, depends on probably on the budget, how big the brick is. In our house, where I live, at site where the sun is shining on in the afternoon, and I always feel that this wall is getting warm. And I know the heat transmitting through this wall is so big that I have to use the air conditioning then when I cannot ventilate it away. And Egypt doesn't use any, I haven't seen the use of insulation material, for example, which doesn't make people think it doesn't make sense, because it's not so cold as in Jordan. That's what I often heard, but it's much hotter than in Jordan, and what prevents the energy to leave the house from inside outside also works vice way, works the other way around, from the outside to the inside. So we should think about using maybe insulation material or using other materials, materials which have lower conductivity or which might be used in a larger dimension to reduce the heat transmitted. We have to calculate such things as well. And then we see what is the usual solution for this overheating. Then that's the techniques which is used. This is air conditioning technique. And what I would opt for first is here, again, the example from the American University, the shading of the windows or the openings, which prevents a lot of the heat gains in advance. Techniques, anyway, still can be used to cover the remaining energy needs, and there are some, not a lot, but some quite interesting examples. This building here is a school, or is belonging to a school in Damascus, where the French gymnasium, higher school, and I think Transolar, or people from Transolar, but the Transolar was involved in developing these chimneys here, which you can see have a kind of glass structure in front of a dark background, so they heat this chimney up with the sun shine, and due to this upheating they create an airflow through this chimney into these schools. Other uses, of course, are very normal, just water heating here, and of course, we can also produce electricity through solar panels. These is sometimes in remote areas here in Egypt, like this is here somewhere at the Nasser Lake. You have the panels here because it's the only option for electricity in this area, but why not using it to a bigger extent? And when we talk about these issues, the solar powers, why not, for example, if we need air conditioning, using or working on solar-powered air conditioning instead of the usual compression-wise working air conditioning here in the country. This would be, make, I think, a lot of things, because when the sun is most in the summer and most intense also, then we could, we have also the biggest needs and we have the biggest reward from it. Yeah, another question I want to raise, it's not too long anymore, is how can we help maybe the poor? There's a lot of poor people here living in shacks like this one, for example, or this one here to post pictures in the North Cemetery. And I always thought, yeah, of course, maybe we could help them. Like here, this is a situation or in Masra in the south of the Dead Sea in Jordan, and people still, also people here are also very poor and living in tents or concrete constructions, but you can see here they use solar power for the electricity needs. Probably, I don't know how this happened, but they have a solar panel there beside the tent, and there's a battery integrated, so probably it will be enough for the lighting needs in the night, not for much more. But they have it. Another idea I got is when we have these shacks here, I sometimes ask myself when I see a shack like here on this side, which is, not nice. Of course, this is also maybe not nice in a very poor situation for the people, very poor living condition, but consists of the earth, and we know that this has better climatical values. So probably I would suppose that people feel more happy inside here in the summer than into this construction. And then I then know, on the other hand, that there's a lot of unemployed people here in this country, and earth doesn't cost much, so I ask sometimes myself, couldn't we train the people and couldn't we create a kind of labor for these people, going back to the traditions here, and make them learn about their own building heritage again, and build houses for themselves. Could this be a participatory approach with a student group from the German University for this book community, which I showed before? We were asked to help them, and what they wanted there were two toilets, because they didn't have a sanitary unit over there. So we, in a one-day action, just went down there for one day, tried to build something with earth. We tried to, we tried different methods of building, the usual block building here. We filled tomato boxes, because these people live from picking tomatoes. They have these boxes, we filled these boxes with the earth. And then we wanted to ram earth inside this timber frame, but we didn't have the time. And then we find out, oh, we just take palm leaves and fill it for toilets, it's enough. And this is what we did in this project. Hasan Fathi, of course, is always mentioned in this context of earth building in Egypt, and people always refer to him. And we see here this mosque in Elgona or in Paris, in the Western Desert Community Center, which was never inhabited. So he didn't have to, I have the feeling he's very well known, but he didn't really succeed, maybe because he built in the wrong time, and times are changing now, and now we could try to use this. But I always also like to raise the question for the image of this earth construction, and I think when we do something for our times, we also have to work on the image of the design we work on. What we see is something like this. This is a normal picture here. I took this in Luxor. You see the old houses, the old climate appropriate clay houses are deteriorating, and beside you find the new construction here. And I ask myself, what is it, this, and what is the need and the longing these people are looking for when they construct such new houses? And can we talk about this with them, or can we just give them the image if they want to have it, but use the old materials, or what can we do? I think this could be a discussion. And when I come to Siwa or other places in the deserts, I always also see that the people build the new houses, but in summertime that they live in the old houses, which at least the room or something that they try to still to keep from the old materials, from the kashif here, or from the mud brick. And people usually then would sit here where the wind goes through, and where we have a big thermal mass and nicely shaded, and so on. Yeah, I saw in Dachau, I found this house construction, and somehow I thought maybe this is something, because I saw it in a repeated way, the people accept, maybe because it looks modern, but it still refers to the old tradition. There are no balconies, but it has loggias, and the material is still, you cannot see it here as projector, but it's still clay brick material, but covered with a new plaster, which probably has some cement in it, but yeah, maybe this could also be a solution. I don't know. Thank you. If there are questions now, or
what would you think would be the most efficient first measures that could give a big return in, for instance, energy efficiency during under the local circumstances in, say, Cairo? Or
I would focus on something like design and build, actually, to work with the people, and maybe if that should have a bigger impact on the local building, could start to train people. In building, and when you build with them and start them training in these constructive issues, maybe on the wall picker or using other materials or covering the concrete construction. If you have to stick with the concrete construction, I think there's earthquake reasons here in the informal settlements around Cairo. So I think this could have an impact, actually, to train people, to work with people, and to develop something with them and out of them, out of their needs, and also the effort for all that.
Usually not a very common question to ask when we'll be talking about sustainable architecture, but how does the land value plays a role in defining which one could be named, which technique, which methodology could be appropriate for a place to be called green architecture, sustainable architecture at least. I've seen the photos that you presented in the beginning comparing these glass curtain walls in Amman, and I can also see it maybe on the Nile here, but from a planning point of view, from a feasibility point of view, there is a need for that because of the land value, not because of the people who only appreciate. They might also be appreciating that this is a modern view and blah, 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 but list an issue of land value and how they can break even with the investment of the capital they look in. And unless I think the argument can lead to a purposeful decision from the owners that still that works for them economically, they will not respond to environmental aspects, I think.
Maybe I understand you're wrong, but to use a glass curtain is now how is this question concerned connected with the land value? Because if I use a glass curtain or if I use a closed wall with smaller openings, doesn't change anything on the land value.
No, they are quite related, because if you're talking about land value, you're talking about how many floors I should build in order to break even, at least not even to bring profit. And for this number of floors, you need a special plan of structure that might be a bit complicated. And because of the land value, you need the maximum usable space, and for that you need the thinnest envelopes and walls. You know, it's all subsequent decisions.
I understand your question now. Maybe you are also referring to this one picture where I saw where I compared these terraced houses with the building blocks. But this is the new settlements which are taking place around Cairo, where I think there is an abundance of land. It's an abundance of desert land that is taken, and it's a little bit less dense, but adds to the quality of living and the energy efficiency, then it's worse. And if I go to the locations on the River Nile where they raise the hotel towers or office towers nowadays, I think, of course, we can first on these locations, I wouldn't say don't build skyscrapers because there's too much energy in the construction. Of course, in these dense locations, skyscrapers should have a place also. But I think to use the glass or the curtain wall or to change it against let's say a sandwich panel element and reduce the openings on the south side maybe to 20-30% of possible opening space would add a lot to the energy efficiency and would pay back after in such a skyscraper after a short time. Even if the panel is a little bit thicker, maybe it is 10 centimeter and the window is just 5 centimeters and takes a frame, so 6 centimeters. So I think this doesn't have the big importance here.
If I may comment, I have a comment for the question. I think why we want to wear the same dress everywhere. I do believe that we have 5%, as we have seen in the map, inhabited in the Nile Valley and the Delta, and we have 95% of the area uninhabited. The point here is that you can generate solutions also for 95%, this is one. Even in the informal settlements inside Cairo, the idea of land value here, I see it not relevant if we take into consideration to go for the benefit of people. For example, these people are inhabiting this area in Guaya, for example. And we see, or developers see, the area is really high value. So then let us think about this should be towers. But this is really, actually, we can really have another strategy. If we only just kick these people out and just like put towers and then starting to think about different techniques for the towers, this is fine. Also, techniques for the towers does exist, and we can really add some energy efficiency measures, but at the end of the day, we need other solutions for other parts of the country. So alternatives are needed, And I don't see the corner. I don't see that we should be cornered every time talking about energy efficient building in towers, or talking about, for example, how we could really build skyscrapers with earth. I don't think that this is a bad question.
Yes, a question.
Just a comment. I think that as we have a strategy for the upcoming of future buildings, I think we need also to solve the problem of the existing buildings that we have. Because especially I still insist that the residential sector is a very effective sector in terms of energy consumption and water consumption and even solid waste management. So this sector needs to be solved, and there is very simple solutions that we could use that could really help, such as shading devices, ventilation, night ventilation, very, very simple strategies that we could use. But unfortunately, we still have the problem of awareness in Egypt. So we still don't feel how this could really help, maybe because of the subsidized energy, maybe because of subsidized water tariff, and so on. So we still didn't feel that. We started to feel it after the revolution. We were standing in lines in front of petrol stations and started to feel how energy is really valuable. I don't want us to end up feeling that so we could have measurements. We have to react before this crisis really comes. I don't really want to feel pessimistic, but this is the truth. So I think that he showed us very important examples of high-rise residential buildings we could support. So I saw a couple of examples in Yemen, in Hadramaut, where they built high-mass buildings up to 8 stories, which could help. But it's also a matter of culture, and would people really accept something like that? So it's a little bit tricky here.
Just agree.